go around. Very grateful to once again be hosting this. We ask that everyone will just come in and find a place. We know that probably not enough chairs, but just find a place to be. And if there's an empty chair somewhere, just direct someone to those chairs. Please don't hold chairs for anyone. We want to have a wonderful evening. Schedule a good program, and we hope that everyone will enjoy themselves. Remember the reason why we're here. We're going to ask everyone to stand at this time as Evangelist Yvonne Durham will give us the invocation.
Down one more time, we're going to ask you. I want to welcome you all here, especially the kids. That's what this is about, kids. Pay attention to this program tonight. This is for you. It's for us, but it's more importantly for the kids. So that's it. I want to welcome you here. I'm so happy you're here. And my sister, Angel's daughter, I can't add anything to what you said. It was a beautiful, beautiful prayer. I thank you for that. Enjoy yourselves. Enjoy the program. Thank you.
Thank you.
County Commissioner Ruth Dansker. Assistant DA Melissa Murphy, also head of the cleaning squad here in Norristown. Our Capitol President, Marge Hunsicker. Certainly thank everyone for your support in this program. This time we're ask Reverend Hemsey Jones, Helen Hemsey Jones, to come and do our taking time to remember.
Remembering is a gift. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die, a time to work and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to speak and a time to be silent. At this time, we come to remember. To remember September the 11th, 2001, to remember parents, grandparents, siblings, children, aunts, uncles, spouses, friends, and those who have paved the way in history for us. We are told that all of us will grieve, but may you find true comfort in knowing that God has promised never to leave us nor forsake us. Yes, we will miss our beloved, but we'll comfort knowing that they're safe in the presence of God. For it is written, if God is for us, who can be against us? In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any power, nor any height, nor depth, or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. The Lord is near, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guide your heart and your mind as you remember your loved one.
Thank you.
And later, when I asked some people I worked with at Peekaville if they knew who Frank Douglass was, they had no clue who Frank Douglass was, whether he was black or white, or nothing about his accomplishments. And I think one of the things I'd like this new Monday in celebration serve to do is give us an opportunity to remember and recall the exploits of many people who have gone before us and have made this life that we have today possible. So I want to talk to you a little bit about Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass was born on the eastern shore of Maryland. He was born in the year 1818. He was born a slave. He didn't know how old he was until he was 17 years of age. When he learned, he heard his master tell someone that he was 17 years old in the year 1835. Facts like this were kept from slaves. Slaves were kept in total and utter ignorance about all events occurring in the world now and then.
Taken from their homes. Although he was a child, seven or eight, he yet never accept the commonly held notion that God had made things the way they were, and this was a good system. On learning the truth that these people were compelled to be slaves against their will, Douglass became obsessed with the notion of being a free man one day. And in his own words, he says, "All the power of slavery were unable to silence or extinguish this inborn dream." During this nascent period, he was sent to Baltimore to live and serve Mr. and Mrs. Hugh Hall. Hugh was a brother of Thomas Hall, who actually owned Douglass. It was Mrs. Hugh Hall who taught Douglass the alphabet. In light of all of our problems with our educational system and the school takeover in Philadelphia, she taught Douglass the alphabet. She was a deeply religious woman, and she wanted to teach him to read the Bible. When Hugh learned what she was doing, he raised Cain at her, forced her to stop these lessons. But she had already opened the door to freedom for this boy. And he always appreciated the fact that she tried to teach him and he cared for her. He had only seen his mother three or four times during his lifetime. And in some ways he regarded Sophia Hall as his mom. Douglass learned that his mother was only one person in her slave community who could read. And I think this was an inspiration. He continued to learn from young white boys in the streets of Baltimore. He purchased the Columbian Orator for 50 cents and learned the speeches it contained on the subject of Catholic emancipation, the war, the American war, speeches by William Pitt and Fox. He read newspapers he found in the streets and discovered that there were abolitionists. He had no idea what they were or who they were. But the angry, worried comments from the old house told him that these abolitionists must be friends. At the age of 13, as the wave of Methodism swept the countryside, Douglass's religious nature was awakened by a speech by a Methodist minister named Olson. But it was the teaching he received from an old freed black man named Lawson who began to inculcate genuine Christian faith in him. He truly loved this old man. He taught him that the Lord could make him free, that all things are possible if only you have faith in God. If you want liberty, ask God for it, and he will give it to you. Douglass spent the next few years teaching other slaves to read. And in his late teens, perhaps the age of 18, he concocted a plan of escape, and five other men joined him in this plan. They had planned to steal a large canoe and row out into the Chesapeake Bay toward the headlands and turn north. This was not a good plan. If you've ever been on the Chesapeake Bay, it's virtually the size of the ocean. The storms and the rough waters, they never would have made it. But before they could execute their plan, they were betrayed. Douglass had written passes for each of them. These passes were never caught because they didn't realize that he could write. It was a crime, it was a federal crime, to teach a slave to read and write. Four of the men were shipyard and was forced to leave his job because the white workers refused to work. Refused to work with him and attacked him viciously. There was much contention between the Irish immigrants and the black workers. The immigrants did not recognize the right of black men to work and viewed black men as obstacles to their economic advance. So Douglas was forced to hire himself out. Eventually, he got his own apartment and was able to pay people $3 a week. And it was during this period that he formulated his second plan of escape that proved successful. Only after emancipation did Douglas reveal the details of this escape. Many successful escapes were published, and all they served that served to do was to prevent future escapes. So he vowed not to publish his, the details of this escape. He had a coping spirit, a young woman named Ann Irving. They were engaged. And she sold her feather bed to raise money for the trip. Douglas had secured a pass, a seaman's pass, that was used by sailors on international waters from a free black man. And that was the method by which he got on a train and ended up in Wilmington, Delaware, which at that time was free territory. Got a steamer to Philadelphia, and the next day he caught a train and went to New York City. He wrote Anne Murray, she joined him. They found people who were in the Underground Railroad, and they were sent into New Bedford, Massachusetts. They were married, and Douglas began his life there as a free man. He found work, but he could never work in the shipyards. It was highly skilled labor. A man could make $9 a week at that labor, and it was covered. But he was able to take care of his family and make a living. He got interested in abolitionism. When he first got to New Bedford, because he was a runaway slave, he needed a name. And he took the name Johnson. But there was only one problem. Everybody who ran away took the name Johnson. So everybody knew your name was Johnson. You were a runaway. So somebody told him, you should change his name. And he picked the name out of Sir Walter Scott's poem, The Lady of the Lake. And that's how he got the name Douglas. All these years, I never knew that Douglas was an alias. His actual name was Frederick Augustus Washington Bailey. He began to subscribe to The Liberator, which was published by William Lloyd Garrison, who was one of the radical abolitionists from Massachusetts. And once, when he was asked to speak and describe his life as a slave, quite successful, he was asked to become a regular member of a group of men who lectured about the evils of slavery and who were deeply opposed to the system. Douglas campaigned tirelessly, started his own newspaper called The North Star, and began to publish it out of Rochester, New York. Douglas continued to speak, and people noticed how well he spoke. Remember Colin Powell? He speaks so well. And Douglas was an eloquent speaker. And because of his eloquence and the fact that he was so literate, people began to wonder if he'd ever been a slave. Began to accuse him of being a fraud. It was a sham, it was a trick. As a result of this, he wrote his first book, The Narrative of the Life of President Douglas, an American Slave, detailing places, names, and dates. There was only one problem. sum of $711.66 was paid to Hugh Wall and his manumission papers were filed in Baltimore, and he was able to return to America. He picked up, he continued to work because wherever he was, he confronted slavery. Slavery was a problem of the West, and although there were no slaves in England, political power and economic power resided in this. He was tireless in his cause to end slavery, and he made friends with John Brown, who we all know was a very militant opponent to slavery. He knew John Brown for many years, but when Brown described his plan of capturing Harper's Ferry, Douglas recognized that this was a crazy plan, that there was no way out, that they were in the Pinto Valley, that the outlet could be blocked, and they were all going to be captured. He didn't go. First foremost, the principal reason he didn't join John Brown, Frederick Douglass was a nonviolent man, much like Martin Luther King. And he didn't tell him his violence. When John Brown was captured, Douglass' name was found among his papers, and a warrant was put out for his arrest, and once again he had to leave the country for a while. Despite his fame, Frederick Douglass was not secure. The laws did not protect him. But he never wavered in his belief that political agitation would politicize the non-slaveholding population to resist the spread of slavery. There was a great political struggle. People who owned slaves wanted to spread slavery to every part of the Union. And they were aggressive in their attempts. And that culminated in the war. Douglass did not favor attempts to relocate freed blacks to Africa or Central America. He did not advocate the voluntary overthrow of slavery. He supported the right of women's suffrage. And as Abraham Lincoln began to take a public stand against slavery, even though it was tepid, he became a supporter of Abraham Lincoln and a friend of Abraham Lincoln. And when the Civil War started, Douglass urged blacks to enlist and fight for their freedom. His two sons enlisted in the 54th Massachusetts Infantry Regiment and survived the war. He began at that time also to fight for black emancipation after the emancipation, black equality after the emancipation, because he recognized that the right to vote and political rights were going to be the key to freedom. He served four presidents: Grant, Hayes, Garfield, Harrison. He served as a commissioner for the country of Haiti at the World Exposition in 1892. He delivered the eulogy for Abraham Lincoln on April 15th following Lincoln's assassination. He published four newspapers in his time. He published a novella. It was a novella about a slave mutiny on a slave ship that occurred in 1841. He published three versions of his autobiography. And he lectured tirelessly to abolish slavery. Frederick Douglass is a worthy representative for us to recognize and remember. There were so many others who were as tireless, as fearless, as courageous. But I cannot close without addressing the debt that America owes to the people who were slaves and unknown in America and the Caribbean. The lives of white people and black people have been changed dramatically by the work and toil and suffering of these unnamed people. The West was made rich and became mighty as a result of the African slave trade. And this debt must be acknowledged, just as Germany finally acknowledged its responsibility for the Holocaust to the Jewish people. We stand on the backs of our ancestors, on their shoulders, in their uplifted hands, and we have an obligation to continue the struggle for full selfhood and to fight for those cannot fight for themselves. The hungry, the homeless, the condemned. jailing of hundreds, nor by the political intimidation of thousands by J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI and COINTELPRO, nor by the Reagan Revolution, nor by the assault on affirmative action, nor by the assault on public education. The transformation continues here in this town as we face the need to redesign ourselves, our schools, our businesses, our buildings, our centers. There's a great movement and vitality here, and we're all part of it. We are not what we were when I first came to Norristown in 1965. What will we do now with this opportunity? Frederick Douglass needed only the teaching of the alphabet to unleash his dream. What will we become? I want to read you the last stanza of Maya Angelou's poem, Still I Rise. Out of the hush of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. On the black ocean leaping and wide, swelling and swelling, I bear in the tide, leaving behind nights of terror and fear. I rise into a day breath that's wondrously clear. I rise, bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise.
Educator assistant, Norristown Area School District. This is dedicated. heading to the borough in our town, presented to Mayor Jay LeBlanc, February 13, 2002. Outside is a picture of a colored school. This is from 1839 to 1883. The next stage is called Moving Ahead. This is from 1883 to 2002. The color is black. Are you moving in the direction for positive achievement? Have you come a long way? Yes and no, one might say. But a giant step was taken back in the day. Joseph K. Saltwood, a member of the Norristown School Board, stood up in reality. He said, on this issue, we must agree that segregated building on Powell Street in Chihuahua, free those colored kids in with the other schools. This separation can't be. Sell that building their house in, integrate us all. Without unity, we are certain fall. For you black students, be black with unesteemed pride. Being lazy is to do the backward slide. Educate your mind with positive goals, and gradually you will see your success unfold. Yes, be black in a positive manner. Dot Walls Elementary was named for this gentleman, Joseph K. Dot, former school board member of the Norristown Area School District. I give Mayor Jay LeBlanc and Captain Willie.
Thank you.
Bryce County, and y'all had that, of what they sort of, as a school board member, she is naturally interested in how students in the North Country meet Ash, is involved in the parish club, sports producers, and also gave donations to things that students need from today's business. For example, she helps to get these new uniforms for sports. She is currently involved in a program called the Institute, which reads out the crime and plans to so that the community can grow. Along with the community project, there is also a project called the Work Project, which is working to make North Carolina the way it was years ago. As you can see, Mrs. Ash has many responsibilities, but along with those responsibilities comes opportunity to do something great. Mrs. Ash is taking those opportunities and giving Norristown community a fun, festival, and accessible image for other local people to see. Just like the little engineers that could say, I think I can, I think I can. Mrs. Ash has volunteered to us to make things better.
God Wall has been.
first Black Heritage Award is awarded to Bill M. Davenport.
Thank you.
Guardstown all his life. He's a veteran of the United States Air Force. Graduated from Howard Law School and has been practicing law in Guardstown for many years. He's a member of the Army and Pennsylvania Bar Association. He's an active member of St. Augustine's Pinho Church. He's involved in various other community organizations and activities. He's a member of the Guardstown Elks, Mount Frisco Lodge, and he's a life member of the NAACP. He believes in and participates in the revitalization of Guardstown. Never felt that Guardstown has gone down too far. He believes it's one of the best places in the United States to live, and that's why he lives in downtown Guardstown. And we're very fortunate to have this perspective, to meet people like him who contribute in his own community, to his community, and who feel that way. That's the only way we want to move ahead. Mr. Smith? Played ball Spencer Backfield coach at Bishop Penrith High School for 2 years. He was the director of Camp Rainbow and Edgewood House, past president of the George Washington Carver Community Center, the founder of the state-mandated Union Relations Commission for the Norristown Area School District. He was the director of the Patrician Society of Central Norristown, CYO Region 21, and a member of the Archdiocese of Austin's Athletic Board for 11 years. He was a member of the St. Catholic Charity Appeal of St. Patrick's Parish. I imagine no witness, but great legacy still goes on. And I'm very appreciative of that. Enjoyed working with Norristown PAL, the children, and the police department, because I know Sal personally, these words do reflect some of the things he does, but they don't reflect everything he does. I can tell you that he is always there. Whenever anyone walks into his office with their hand out, which happens quite a bit, he's there for it. Latest one thing is seeing these jugs in the 7-Eleven and all look like big gallon jars of mayonnaise. That's Sal Gambo putting them down there. That's fundraising for the town. So he never stops. He's always giving. And I'm proud to call my friend, Sal Gambo.
Out there who want to help us because they know that everybody involved in PAL are volunteers. We have volunteers. they coach basketball teams, they keep score. We've been active now for many years, but within the past 4 years, we got more active than we ever have been. Thanks to those volunteers, because Willie can't do it all himself. I can go out and beg for money and raise money, but you need volunteers. Now, the one message I want to get to you people, any of you, if you know anybody that wants to help us, whether it's the coach, whether it's the referee, keep score, anything, if you have any ideas for programs, you can call us. You can always call the police department. We've been fortunate too. We just left, and I want to thank him. Since we have the chief, he's behind us 100%. He gives us support. He encourages the police officers to participate. So I can tell you, we're very, very fortunate. I think everybody from the district attorney's office, the sheriff's department, see, it's important to get those people involved, because the police athletic thing, okay, it's police. It's a Norristown police. The most important thing is to have these children love Willie and all the other policemen and look toward them as their friend, not just a guy in uniform that's going to yell at him or blow a whistle. And the thing is, that's why we got the district attorney's office involved whenever we can, the sheriff's department, and they're all out there for us. So we really have an opportunity. But before I finish, I would like to say one last thing, that I won't be quiet. You know, having grown up in Norristown, there's been some outstanding people that have really gone before us. I say us, Willie and I and a few others. There's one gentleman here nodding his head. When I mentioned this fellow's name, who remembers? Stanford Smith. How many of you in the crowd, raise your hand if you ever heard of Stanford Smith? A couple of you, okay? Stanford Smith used to sponsor baseball teams and basketball teams and sporting teams out of his pocket. And I knew that because I was about that high. And as I got a little older, I noticed that Charlie McPherson, Charlie Mack played for Stanford's team. And the next gentleman, I'm going to ask him to stand up, because he's been a role model for Norristown. He's been an outstanding citizen, coaching children. Skag Coffin, you got to stand up.
Douglas, who we heard elegantly spoken tonight.
much without them, without these pops. We also want to thank Mr. Doris Stark for the decoration. We also want to thank Eisenhower Middle School students, Stewart Middle School students, Eisenhower Middle School High School Vocational Program for our souvenir books, and we also want to thank Pathmark for the coloring books and the teaching books. But also, I just want to personally thank all of my pal kids for being here this evening. They were obedient, they were here, and great memories. This program is for our children. We want them to remember their heritage, and we want them to continue this heritage. So we want to thank them for being here. We want to thank the parents for bringing your children here for this program and for teaching them and bringing them up in the right direction. Norristown is going away back. I don't care what anybody says. I live here. My children, I raised my children here, and I'm here to stay. I don't know about anybody else.
Give us peace. We pray. Amen.
Amen.